Hello, guys. Can you hear me? Okay, great. So, any questions before we formally start? Final week, huh? Final week. Okay, yeah, our final week. Yeah, I think we still have 5 minutes or so. So can you guys see my screen? Lecture 15, concurrency, semaphore. Hello, guys. Okay, thank you. Okay, I guess we can start. Okay, so our final week. Yeah, so this week we will finish everything. And yeah, tomorrow I will wrap up, introduce the final exam. Okay, so in this week's tutorial, tutor will introduce conditional variable again from implementation perspective, and also give you some exercise to do, a very simple one. So before we talk about semaphore, okay, last week we talked about a conditional variable. Of course, we also talk about log, right? So how to implement log. Then our major effort last week is on conditional variable. Particularly, we utilize a classical concurrency problem, producer and consumer, to introduce conditional variable. I really like those examples. Basically, I think a textbook gave us very good examples. Start with use if, when we use a conditional variable. Then what happened? Then go through, use only one conditional variable. Then finally, we have two conditional variable, a complete solution, right? So, because today we will talk about this again. So the general idea is very simple. Basically, the general case is that we have a buffer. So in the beginning, we want this as an integer, right? So this buffer, we have a conditional, we have a state to describe this buffer. This state is if the buffer counter equal to zero, which means buffer is empty. If counter equal to one, which means buffer is filled. Okay, so from producer perspective, basically producer need to check, right? Well, right, because producer, right? Producer need to say, okay, if the buffer is full, right? So if counter equals one, right? So producer need to wait for empty, right? Need wait for until buffer become empty. So wait empty, this condition variable. So after that, if wake up, which means the buffer has been consumed, then we can signal. Fail. See, okay, we fail this, then send a signal, right? Basically, this is a producer. Consumer correspondingly consumer first need to check, because I'm the consumer, so I need to check whether or not the buffer is empty. If it's empty, then I need to wait. So basically this equal to zero, then we should wait. Wait for what? Wait for, if this is empty, we need to wait until the buffer is filled. So wait filled. Okay, sooner or later, consumer may be wake up by producer send a signal. So hey, filled already, okay? Then we can consume it, then send signal to empty, because we already consume it, then this buffer become empty again. So the producer waiting for a conditional variable can be waked up. Okay, basically that's what we discussed through this producer consumer. Of course, we also need to use log by entering into this critical section. So we'll talk about this again, use a semaphore to solve it. So semaphore is another way to handle concurrency issue. It's simpler than conditional variable. You can see here, the definition is like this, okay? Semaphore. When we define a semaphore, then we have two arguments. We have three arguments. First, we have to input the which semaphore, right? We want to initialize. Okay. Then this zero means okay, we want to share this semaphore between the threads. Okay. So usually this is the purpose when we use a semaphore, we want to share among different threads. Okay, so this value usually is zero. Then this is the initial value. Okay, this is a different from conditional variable. So basically, conditional variable, we don't have a initial value. We do have a state variable, but in semaphore, we don't have state variable. We have this called initial value. Okay, so let's go through to look at this, how it works, okay, based on this initial value. So this is initialization. Then we have two routines. First is wait and post. Second is the post. Basically, wait is similar to wait we discussed in the conditional variable. The post is similar to signal we discussed for conditional variable, okay? So first, let's look at wait. Wait is kind of simple. You can see here, basically the operation is decrement the value of semaphore S by one, okay? Then wait if the value of a semaphore is negative, okay? We have a Q over there. Then if the value is negative, after decreased by one, then we should wait. Okay, so look at this description here. So if, when we call sum wait, if the value for this sum value, so what is the value, initial value, right? We assign the value. So for each sum of them, we associate with a value. If this value is one or higher, then return right away. After we decrease this value by one, then return immediately. Okay. Otherwise, which means, okay, if this value is zero or lower, okay, then the call will be suspended and waiting for a subsequent post, another routine we call. Okay. So generally speaking, one or higher, decrease by one, then return. Zero or lower, decrease by one, then suspend, waiting for the post. Okay. Then another attribute from semaphore is that when negative, this value of the semaphore is equal to the number of waiting threads. So basically, we can look at this value, then we know how many threads are waiting for this semaphore, on this semaphore. Okay. Another operation is post. This is a similar to signal, right? Signal in a conditional variable. So same post first increment the value of semaphore by one. Okay. Then if there are one or more threads waiting on this semaphore, wake up one. Okay, which one? No idea. Okay, just wake up one. Okay. So description, simply increment the value of semaphore. That if there's a thread waiting to be woken, wakes one of them up. That's it. Okay. So you can see the grammar here is simpler, right? Basically. Yeah. Let me see. Wake is random. Wake one of them, right? Basically, we cannot guarantee which one to be waked up. We can only guarantee one will be waked up. Okay. So in that sense, yes, that's random. Yeah. So is this clear? Yeah. Basically, we have two routine, right? So first is we can do. First we can do wait. When we wait, decrement the value. Then if the value is negative, then wait. Okay. Otherwise, just the return. Okay. The post is increment the value. Then wake up one thread. Okay. No matter this, it doesn't matter. Okay. Current value, just if we call post, we just increment the value, then wake up one of them. Okay. So let's look at, we can use a semaphore to design a lock. Mutual exclusive. So for example, we can initialize the value here. Okay. So for example, we have this semaphore. We want to utilize this as a lock. Then basically this value should be one, right? Then when we wait, if we have the first thread to call this sample wait, then because this value is one, then after we decrement the value, then it becomes zero. But because this is a one or higher, right? The value is one or higher. So the first thread can enter into the critical section. Other thread, when called, will wait for the post, right? Okay, so basically that's the idea. So let's look at utilize this example to show how it works. Okay, suppose we have two threads. Thread zero called sum wait. Then from sum wait, return, then we enter into a critical session, then call send post, then from send post return, right? Okay, so here you can see that suppose after we thread zero here, right? So the initial value is one because we want to utilize this sample as a log. So we set up the initial value as one. Then after we call sum weight, the value, sample value become zero. Okay. Then we enter into the critical session. We try to utilize, we try to use the critical session. Executed the critical session. However, interrupt occur, we switch to the thread one. Thread one always ready at this moment, okay? Then after switch, call, go to the thread one, call send wait, okay? So when we call send wait, we decrement the value. So sample value become minus one, okay? So because this value is minus one, negative, so thread one sleep on this semaphore, okay? Thread one is sleep now. Then somehow because it's sleep, so we give up the control, then switch to thread zero, for example, okay? Then continue, thread one, thread zero continue, finish the critical session, then call post. When we call post, the kernel will look at the thread that are waiting for on this semaphore. Then we can see here, oh, we only have thread one. So we wake up thread one. Okay, of course, we also increment semaphore. Okay. Then sum return, then finish the critical session. Suppose the interrupt occur at this moment again. Okay, then here you can see the first one, we, when we increment the semaphore, then the sample value becomes zero at this moment already, okay? Okay, then after we switch to thread one return from sample wait because we wake up, right? Okay, then enter the critical session, call some post, then the sample value become one. Okay, so if we have other thread that call some wait, then now this thread can enter into the critical session. Okay. So basically that's, this example shows the basic function, how some of them works. Okay, so I'm, let me go to see some, I found some question from chat book. So let me answer those questions. So any questions, then please, yeah, input your question into the chat box. Okay, so the question, let me see, okay. So this is very important. The basic function is very important. Okay, so let me suspend, then suspend. Oh, sorry. I think maybe I didn't copy those questions. Yeah. Yeah, please continue to input your question. Yeah. So waking is random, yeah. Waking is, we can only wake up one, right? So in that sense is wake up one thread, right? Yeah, post can only wake up one thread. So in that sense, this is no guarantee, cannot specify which one, which one, right? So basically, maybe in that sense, from that perspective, we can see that this is random. What is different between wait and suspend? Where is the wait and suspend? Wait is suspend. Yeah, I don't. Which one, which part you are talking about, I think? Slide page 5. Okay, so maybe I will go back to answer this question about the wait and the suspend. So it said when, then wait, when zero and then suspend. Okay, page 5. Okay. Yeah, I will go back to that. But lock is not used, so I don't understand this question. So lock is not used. Actually, we implement a lock, right? Use this semaphore, right? So M become a semaphore, right? When we call sem post, sem wait, sem post, basically we already utilize this M is our log. So this is similar to log, right? So that's exactly what we try to do. We want to use, for example, sem init initial value is one, then M is log, M zero as a log. Right, I hope I answer your question. So I think maybe you guys confused what is the semaphore, why we want to use semaphore. Right? So basically semaphore is another way to. It's similar to the conditional variable. Semaphore is used to solve the concurrency problem. Similar to the conditional variable. Okay, it's another way, okay, we used to manage this mutual exclusive and also other concurrency issues, right? It's similar to a conditional variable, yeah. So this is why we can use semaphore to implement a lock. If initial value is one, then this M become a lock. Okay, then we can use semaphore wait and post served as a lock. Okay, there's no log, but this is a log, right? So we implement, yeah. Is this clear? Yeah, I noticed there are some other questions. Yeah, so yeah, let me copy those questions. Yeah, I will go back to look at the wait and the suspend, right? Slides page 5. But before that, let me answer my question here related to the semaphore. Can you explain what is the user semaphore? Yeah, I think I already answered these questions. Is semaphore equivalent to use multiple conditional variable? Yeah, actually semaphore is kind of similar to one conditional variable. One semaphore is kind of similar to one conditional variable, right? But they are different, okay? So later I will show you, we can use conditional variable to implement semaphore. Yeah, but they are different basically, okay? The major difference is a conditional variable, we have a state, but in semaphore, we don't have this. We yeah, you of course you can add a state, right, when you solve a problem. But it's for the semaphore itself, we don't have a state variable. And also semaphore has value. You see, semaphore, you can assign the value for this semaphore, but a conditional variable, there's no value, right? Think about that. Conditional variable, there's no value. You can only say, I wait for this condition, I signal for this condition, right? But there's no value. For conditional variable itself, there's no value. Of course, we can associate it with a state variable, use a state variable as the value, right? But for the semaphore, you can see that we have a value, so we can directly assign the value. Yeah. So meaning what? Okay. Yeah. Semaphore. No. Semaphore is not an integer, right? Semaphore is semaphore. How to define semaphore, right? Okay. Semaphore is a tool to utilize, is kind of a method, right? Semaphore is a method to manage concurrency problem, to solve the concurrency problem. You think about that. Okay, this is not very easy. It's not only a integer. Semaphore has a value, right? But the semaphore also have a queue. Then based on the queue, then we have different actions, right? And also semaphore's value has meaning. When it become a negative, his absolute value represent how many threads are waiting for this semaphore, right? So it's not only an integer, right? It's it's more difficult than an integer, right? So basically when we implement, later we'll talk about how to implement, but generally speaking, this is a very complicated I think we can see this is a very complicated data structure. Okay. Semaphore is a complicated data structure associated with a value, with a queue, but the purpose is to solve the concurrency problem similar to the conditional variable. Okay, yeah. So let me go back to look at slide 5. Wait as a suspend, right? Yeah, which one? So can you guys see this slide? Same weight? The code said that wait if negative value, but the decrease video said which one is correct. Okay, yeah, both are correct from different perspective. Okay, so generally speaking, you can see here, is that because of the last class? I'm kind of, so you can see here, actually, given this value, right? So given this semaphore, so the first step is decrement the value by one, because this is our operation, okay? The second is wait if the value of the semaphore is negative, right? Okay, so the later part, this description is more like, okay, see that to summarize the operation. So of course we have to decrement the value, right? But this one will see, okay, the description is that if the value is one or higher, okay, see, before the decrement, okay, then return right away, okay. So I just want to describe the second one, right? Otherwise, okay, the caller will be suspended and waiting for a subsequent post, okay. So basically the thread call this function will be suspended, then wait for the post, okay. So are you talking about this suspend and wait? Huh? So basically that means the thread call this semaphore will be put on the queue of this semaphore, then sleep. Okay, so we call it suspend, right? Then we have a post. Well, later we'll have a post to wake up one thread. Yeah, the description is described after decrement. Okay, I'm sorry. Okay, so maybe I should change this one. So let me later I will change this one. Okay, I think this is confused. So first step is decrement the value. The second step, look at. Yeah, the second step is that if it is zero or higher, then return right away. Otherwise, right? Negative, right? Then we suspend. Okay. Yeah, I think this is not clear. So what happened today? Yeah. Okay, I hope you guys can see the screen. Can you? Okay, so is this clear now for this value? So basically here means, yeah, it's very hard to explain. Maybe let me revise this part so you guys can see this clearly. Yeah. Yeah. See, okay. Yeah, this we have two steps, right? Yeah, so basically the first step is decrement the value of the semaphore. Decrement value by one, right? Okay. Then second, if the value is zero or higher, return right away. Otherwise, negative, right? And the caller, right? So now I think you guys should be okay for this one. Is this clear now? Hello? Okay. Okay, so let me continue to talk about sample as conditional variable. Okay. So suppose we want to utilize this to wait for child to be finished. So you can see the program here is that we have a semaphore initialized. So we don't know the value here. Then say parents began, then parents want to wait child to be finished, child thread, right? You can see here we create a child, use a function child. Child is very simple, child just call post, okay, for this semaphore. Then parents, this main thread will call wait until child finish, right? Then send the signal, post, right? So then print out n, right? So the question is, what is the value for x here we should put? So this is different from conditional variable, right? Basically for conditional variable, we don't have this value. We do have a condition. We do have a state variable. We have to use state, but here basically some of them already have the value, right? So what is the value we should put? Let's see, zero, okay? Yeah, you are right, okay? We should put zero. The reason is that, yeah, so let's look at this example. This example also can help us to understand this better. Mm-hmm. So you can see we only have two cases when we run this mean thread and the child thread. Either we have we run parents first, then we run child, right? So the order is that, okay, parents create use p thread, create, then generate the child thread, then we run the parents. Then child is ready, but the child will be run later. Okay. So you can see here, parents after create child call some weight, right? So initial value, suppose initial value is zero, right? So this why this initial value we set up, we put this value as zero, right? So suppose parents call it, parents run first, then the value become minus one. Then because this value become minus one, then parents will wait, right? Based on our semantics, okay. Then after kind of, because this is a sleep, right? Suspend, right? Kind of, yeah. So suspend the operation, let's switch to another thread. So we switch to child to run. Then child call post, increment the semaphore. So after we decrement the semaphore, the value become minus one. Now increment, it becomes zero. Then wake up the parents. So parents is ready now. Okay. Then return, right? Child finish. Then after that, maybe we have a switch back to run. Then because the child has finished, so we return from the wait, then that's great. Our wait has result, right? So basically we can finish in this order. Second order, after we create the child, then before we call some wait, actually we already switch, okay? Child immediately run. Then child send a post, right? Increment the value. The post value become one. There's no thread is waiting for on this semaphore. So we wake up nobody. Then return post. After we return from post, then finish, right? Then after that, we switch back to call parents. Then parents call some wait. Because the value is one now, the value right now is one, right? Then after we call some wait, decrement, then this becomes zero. But remember, if the value is zero, if it is not negative, then we should immediately return, right? So basically we can immediately return, then that's it, finish. Okay, so in both cases, this is correct. Okay, either child run or child run first or parents run first. So this is why this value should be zero. So is this clear? So in your lab exercise, actually, you will face a similar question. However, the question is that we may have multiple threads. Then basically how to utilize conditional variable to wait for all child threads to be finished. Okay, so yeah, if you go to the tutorial, you should be easily finish this question. Yeah, I will talk about some property, okay? So I think one student gave a very good comment. One student say that after we set up this initial value, okay? So basically we cannot your question is a comment or a correct question. Yeah. So that will never be on the initial one. So you guys go to the comments. The value will never go beyond the initial value. That's a good question. I'm not sure actually. I'm not sure. So the question is that the value, right? So the value, so after we call post, right? This value can be greater than initial value or not, okay? I think we can, it depends on how you utilize this, right? So if you just call post, right? Multi-post read, then of course you can make this value go to greater than initial value, yeah. Also, initial value is zero, right? So in this case, actually initial value is zero than our value. Yeah, so you can see here, initial value is zero, right? Then during one period, the value is one, right? So basically the value can be greater than a initial value, right? Right? So the value can be greater than initial value, right? So it depends on how you use the post, right? So it doesn't matter. You just set up an initial value based on your purpose, but basically it can be. Right? Okay, so we go back to the producer and the consumer again. Okay, so let's look at producer and consumer again. So let me first introduce the problem here. Then I will go back. Then maybe you can have a break. Yeah. So basically you can see here, this is our put and get operation, right? Basically our put operation is kind of like put the values, and because our buffer is we may have a multiple integer, right? We have an array here, the capacity is max, right? So basically you can see here, then we can change the value and so on. Yeah. So we need to, after we go to the end of the array, then we should use a modular, then go back to the top of the array, right? Something like that. Yeah. So let's look at the first solution. I can use SAMFA to solve this. Okay. Of course, our initial value is like this. We have two SAMFA we use. The first SAMFA is empty. The value is max. Okay. The second SAMFA is full. The value is zero. Okay. So producer is kind of like checks empty, right? Empty is M. Okay, we check this value M, right? So basically you can think about empty, the maximum value is M, which means we have M empty slots, okay? So we allow M producer thread to enter into this critical session. Okay, to generate data, right? So basically you can see here, to enter here. So after we generate the result, then we say, wake up if we have a consumer thread waiting for the food. Similarly, okay, for the consumer, we check the food. So food's initial value, you can see here, food's initial value is zero, okay? Basically, the idea here is that, okay, so if this full slots is zero, right? Nothing, right? In the beginning, nothing, right? We don't have any, full is zero, right? Then basically initial value is zero, then we will wait, okay, until this is filled. Okay, then after we consume data, we send a signal to empty. See, okay, we already have one empty slot, something like that, right? After we generate, then we will see that we already have one filled slot, something like that, okay? So, the first max value is greater than one because it's our capacity of the ring. The first issue here is that you can see that if there are multiple producer, then risk condition can happen at line F1. So which line? Here, this line, okay? This is our shared variable buffer, right? Is shared among multiple producer, multiple consumer. So we have to guarantee this shared variable is mutual exclusively accessed. So we have to add a lock. Okay, otherwise, after we one thread generated data, then maybe before we finish, then it switched to another thread, another producer to generate. For example, this field is 5, suppose, okay, currently. Then before we say P1, okay, when P1 enter into this critical session to serve, the field, this position is 5, okay. Then before P1 finish, we switch to another producer P2, okay. P2 see, okay, oh, this is 5, so P2 will generate data. Then basically we have the issue, right? Concurrency issue, risk condition. So we need to guarantee this put operation and get operation, this part, right, is mutual exclusive, critical session, our critical session, basically, right? So how to do that? Simple, right? So basically we need to add a mutex. You can see here, now we have a mutex here, use semaphore, right? Initial value is 1. Okay, then we first wait. Then after we exit from our critical session, basically you can see that we just post, right? So this is how we use semaphore to solve this, okay? For the producer and the consumer correspondingly. So you can see here, actually we have problem here, okay? So basically think about that, okay? Suppose consumer run first. This is consumer, right? Consumer run. Consumer first acquire the lock, right? So in the beginning, at this moment, foo is 0. Suppose foo's value is 0. Foo's initial value is 0, right? So because the consumer run first, so no field slot, okay? The foo is 0. So at this moment, because this is 0, then consumer will sleep, right? Think about that. So consumer run first, then consumer will sleep here. Sleep on foo, right? Okay, then next, let's schedule producer to run. Producer to run, say producer say, okay, I want to enter into the critical session first. Then basically after we call this, this is a mutual exclusion, our log. So producer will wait until this log to be released, right? So producer will sleep here. Okay, this is a typical log dialogue. So the reason is that you think about that consumer, right? So first consumer acquire this mutex. So suppose we use this arrow to represent, okay, already obtained the mutex, okay. However, consumer want to be wake up based on the foo, right? Okay, so who can send the who can wake up the consumer waiting for the food? Okay, producer, right? Producer. However, producer basically can help to release this one, right? So we can think about kind of producer is the only hope to generate this to send a signal, then make wake up the consumer. However, producer is waiting for the mutex, right? So basically this is how, so we have a circular wait, basically. You can see that consumer is waiting for producer to wake them up through the food, right? However, the producer is waiting for the mutex. So basically, circular wait, right? So the description here is that basically, consumer acquires the mutex, then consumer calls some wait, then consumer is blocked, yield the CPU. However, consumer still holds the mutex. Remember, in conditional variable, when we call wait, actually we will release the log. Okay, but here, yeah, we don't have such semantics. Okay, if you hold the mutex, you hold the mutex. Then later if a producer run, then call some, then it will wait for the mutex. Then basically we have a dialogue, right? So the problem here is that we need to know which part we should protect, right? When we use the mutex. So basically we want to protect the operation put and the get. So which means we should put our mutex into our critical session. Okay, we cannot put it outside. We should first wait for the empty, then call the mutex. Okay, this way, basically, after wake up, then we compete for the mutex, then enter into critical session to either consume data or produce data. This is the consumer data, right? So, but the general idea here is that after we wake up from either, for example, in this case is we find that there's a field slot, wake up by the producer, then consumer will compete for the log to enter the critical session to consume data, right? Similarly, for the producer, after wake up by consumer, see, okay, oh, we already have empty slots, then we enter into the critical session. We compete for the log, then enter the critical session to consume produce data. Okay, so then in this way, it's okay, yeah. So you can see the empty value is empty slots, how many? Empty slots, the foo is how many field slot, then initial value mutex, right, is one. Okay. So because I need to give you guys 10 more minutes, right, 15 or 10 minutes for the CTE. So how about maybe we should have a break. Yeah, I think it looks like we are okay today. Yeah, so 5 minutes break. Yeah. Yeah, I see some comments here. I will, today I cannot answer your question after the lecture because I need to give you some time for the CTE. So after we come back from the break, then maybe I will briefly talk about the comments. Okay, so let me stop the recording. Okay, from the chat box, I see the Yingho ask a question about the dialogue, right? So let me explain this again. So basically, the dialogue here is that you can see, generally speaking, right? So I think maybe I draw this not very clear, but think about that. Consumer already acquired the log, mutex, right? Acquired the log. So I use this arrow to represent. So producer, when producer run, producer, first thing, producer is called wait, right? So producer try to get the mutex, try to get a log. Okay, so I use this dotted line to represent, right? Then consumer, only way consumer can release log is through the producer to call post here, right? Post for foo, right? So this is why consumer is waiting for producer to wake up on foo, right? So I cannot see that who own this, who control the foo, right? So at this moment, no one acquired the foo. So because foo is not a mutex, the mutex can be, right now I acquired this mutex, but this one is a semaphore, right? Foo is not a, foo is a kind of a conditional variable. It's similar to conditional variable. So no one acquire this one, but producer basically can send a signal, can post, right? Then wake up the thread waiting for the foo. So this is why consumer is waiting for the producer to call post on foo, right? This one, right? So this is why you can see here. So then this is a circular wait. We have the dialogue. Okay, another very classical question is called multiple read. Okay, this is very popular in database or in list operation, concurrent operation. So basically we have a read and write. For example, we want to insert a new item into the list. Or another, we have multiple thread, we want to look up the value, right? Then basically insert means I want to change the state of the list. Of course, when we want to update a value, then definitely we should not allow any read or another write to enter to do the concurrent operation. So generally speaking, we can lock this data structure. For example, if it's a list operation, then we can log the whole list. Okay. So lookup is a read operation. However, read operation is that basically, as long as we can guarantee there's no write, no ongoing write, then we can allow multiple read. Because we see read operation, we don't change the data structure's value. So we just want to get the value. Then we allow multiple read. However, we only allow single write. Okay, if we have write, then no one can, no read, no write, no other write. However, if there's no write, okay, we can have multiple read, right? So basically, this is a very common way to utilize our data structure because after we store our data, of course, we want to have a concurrent read so we can explore the information, right? So typical, this is a typical log we call reader-write log, okay? So reader-writer log, okay, actually is reader-writer log. I have a typo here, is reader-writer log, okay? So, the requirement is that only a single write can acquire the log. Okay, once a reader has acquired a read log, then more read can enter to read. Okay, then the writer have to wait until all readers are finished. Okay, so basically, you can think about a reader have a higher priority, okay, in this case, because if you have multiple reader, then if one reader acquires a log, then it's other, we allow other reader to enter, right? Only when we don't have any reader, then writer can enter, right, basically. So how to design this kind of a log? This structure here, you can see here, basically we have a log here. We have a specific write log. Okay, then how many reader we can record? Okay, initialization is kind of simple. You can see here, reader, how many reader, zero, okay? Then log is our initial log is a mutual exclusive log. So mutex, so basically the initial value is zero. Then our writer also mutual exclusive, initial value is one, okay? Then for the reader, basically, the operation here is we for reader, then reader will use this first. You can see reader will acquire the read log, right? If we have a reader, reader need to call this one. First acquire the log, then after finish, release the log, the reader need to do. The writer is here. If we have a writer need to acquire the write log here, right? Use it, call this function, right? Acquire the write log, then release the write log when I finish. So for the reader, first call this log, mutual exclusion, right? So because we need to kind of enter into this critical session. Here our, we want to guarantee our current, Our common value here for reader, we need to record the how many reader we have. So enter the critical session, we basically increment the reader, okay, one more reader, okay? Then if here equal to one, then we should wait for the write log. So why? So what does that mean here? So generally speaking, that means, okay, if I'm the first reader, I should wait for this log, okay? Say, okay, if I'm the first one, if I could not get a log, suppose, okay, this the writer already doing insert operation. Okay, so I could not get the log, so I have to wait, right? So if I wait, then other reader cannot enter into this critical session. The reason you can see here, right? So this log right here, this log guarantee, if I'm the first one, I will block all other reader to enter into the critical session. So other reader cannot enter. Right? Okay, so then I will wait until I acquire this log. Okay. If I acquire this log, then great. Okay, now I just exit from this critical session. Okay, then you can see this is very interesting. Okay, then you see that, then how about other reader? So you see other reader does not need to execute this one. So why other reader does not need to wait for this write log? Think about that. See, so suppose we have a second reader, right? Second reader come into here, second reader say increase this value. So now the reader value is two, right? Then why second reader does not need to wait for this write log? Yeah, because see, suppose I'm the second reader, What that means? That means the first reader already acquired this write log, right? Otherwise, I cannot become second reader. Think about that. So suppose I'm the second reader, so which means we are ready. Oh, I'm the third reader, fourth reader. Then, which means the first reader already successfully acquired the write log. Otherwise, we will block here, right? No reader can enter into the critical session. Then, if the first reader already acquired the log, okay, great, okay. Then other reader can immediately enter, right? Without check this write log, right? Then basically, that's why we said that reader has a higher priority. Okay, of course, similarly, if one reader want to exit from the critical session, finish this lookup operation, need to return. So we still need to call this log to enter the critical session, then reduce the number of reader. Number of reader is very important, okay? Then if I'm the last reader, the only reader, I'm the only reader, okay? No other reader, okay? I'm the last one. So after minus, then the value becomes zero, right? So I will say, oh, I'm the last one. There's no reader, no more reader anymore. Then at that time, then I release the log, right? Then this time, if a writer come, writer can enter into the critical session. Okay, otherwise, if writer call this, if we have one reader or multiple reader already acquired the log, then writer must wait, okay, until no reader, then we release the log, then writer can enter into the critical session. And similarly, okay, writer will post, right, after finish, right? Is this clear? Any questions about this reader writer? Okay, so reader writer log have a fairness issue. Yeah. Basically, if we have a lot of reader, then writer may not have a chance to run. Okay, we may starve the writer. Okay, so how to prevent? So you need to design a new one. Okay, so this also is a very interesting question. Okay, you can think about. Okay, so let me talk about one more question. Then I think we can stop because you need to, I was told by the department to give you some time to do the CTE, okay? So dining philosophers, okay? So this also is a very classical question. So question is like this, okay? So suppose we have five, right? From zero, we have from zero to four, we have five philosophers, okay, or five persons, okay? Then, because they are the philosopher, so they only do two things, think and eat, okay? So it's very simple life, okay? So nothing else, okay? Then, when we start to eat, the requirement is that a philosopher needs two forks, okay? One on the left, one on the right, okay? Need to pick up two, right? Then if you cannot get two forks, only get one, then you cannot eat, basically, okay? So we have a kind of a competition, right? When you want to get the fork, right, basically. So fork, we also have five forks, okay? We have five forks, okay? So basically, each philosopher need two forks in order to eat. However, we will have five foxes. Okay, you can think about the issue here that suppose we have, if we have 10 foxes, right? So each philosopher has his own fox, then we have no issue. But right now, only have five foxes, then each philosopher needs two foxes. So in total, we don't have five foxes. Definitely we have contention, right? So that's a problem. Basically, we want to solve the problem with that. We don't want to say that we have dialogue. Okay, later I will show you the dialogue. Okay. Then we also don't want to have starvation. Then we want to allow the high concurrency and so on, right? So to solve this problem, then people say that it's simple. Okay. So maybe we can only we can use this one to kind of first think, then get fox, then eat, then put fox. So when we get fox, then basically we first get left one, then we first, then we get the right one. Okay, so you can see here. So because we use the number to represent the fox, so basically if the left directly returns the left one, okay, then if it's right, then we plus one modular five, so return that value. Okay, so after we get left and right, then we can continue, right? So then for the philosopher P, then call left P and right P, okay, based on the different number. Okay, so because the fork is a shared among philosophers, we need to use semaphore to have a mutual inclusion, right, to guarantee mutual inclusion, right? No, see, this only one can get this, right? So we have to guarantee this is mutual inclusive. Then basically when we get fork, then we first get left and then get right, right? When we put fork, then post, right? Left and right, right? Then the problem here is that this is a typical question, right? So suppose philosopher zero, right? First get left, right? Suppose first get left, okay? Now ask for, try to get right, right? At the same time, it may happen, okay? P1 already got F1, waiting for P2, okay? Then similarly, P2 already got F2, waiting for F3, right? Then P3 already got F3, waiting for P4, okay? Then P4 already got F4, waiting for F0. Okay, so we have a circular way. Actually, I give you some program. You can run it, okay? It happened. After a while, then you will find out the dialogue, okay? So I don't have time to run those programs, but I think those programs are very interesting for this concurrency. You run it, then you understand. After you have multiple threads to run at the same time, then if you have some shared variable, then a lot of interesting things happen. Okay. This is the particular case. So why we have this problem? If each philosopher grabs the fox first on the left, then on the right, then we have this issue, right? So because we host one fox, left fox, then wait for the right. Then basically everyone is waiting for, then no one can eat, right? So how to solve this problem is very easy. Okay, so later, tomorrow we will talk about how to break this cycle. So if we have a circular wait, then how about we change this order? Then if we change this order, then basically we don't have circular wait, then we can solve the problem. So the solution here is we can change the order if this is the particular philosopher P4. Okay, if it is the fourth philosopher, then we change the order. So you can see here, we first get right, then go to the left. Okay, so it changed to like this way. Okay, so basically, if this guy first try to get this one, okay, then get this one. First get F0, then get F4. Then you can see the either you think about FP4, okay. Before we have circular wait because we already acquired the F4, right? Then waiting for the F0. Then if we change the order, we first try to acquire F0. Then either we get it or not. If we cannot get, then we will wait here. Then we cannot wait for the F4, right? Okay, if we can not get F4, then P3 can get F4 finally. And P3 can finish. Then P2 can finish. Then P1 can finish. Then P0 can finish, right? Okay, then P4 finally get F0, then get F4, then finish. This first situation. First situation, basically, we cannot get. So if we get it, then P0 cannot get it, right? So P0, if P0 cannot get it, P0 cannot wait for this one, okay? So we break this cycle. Then in this way, basically, we can break, after we break this cycle, then we don't have deadlock. Okay, so this is how we solve the problem. Okay. I still have 8 minutes. Okay, let me finish this xamarin. Okay. How to implement the xamarin? I think maybe this is the question you asked in the beginning. You say, what is xamarin? Right. So I think I didn't prepare very well for that question. So, generally speaking, xamarin is a kind of a tool to help us to solve the concurrency problem. It's similar to the conditional variable, right? So we can use a conditional variable to implement the xamarin. So this is the implementation you can see here. Basically, this from the textbook, they call the xamarin, okay? So basically we have value, we have a conditional variable. Then initial value is that the value we put into, remember our xamarin initial value, we have three value, right? So suppose we forget about the middle value, we always share those values. So most important one is the value, initial value we put, right? So initial value will be put into as our destructure value, right? Assigned as our state value, okay? Then we can use our conditional variable, right? As kind of, if you call xamarin, let's just initialize our conditional variable and also a log. So associated with this conditional variable. Then wait operation, you can see first we enter the critical section, acquire the log. Then if this value is smaller or equal to zero, this is used to emulate the operation of a xamarin. You can see here, if this value is already less than or equal to zero, then we wait, okay? We wait on this condition, okay? Then after that, okay, we minus, okay? Because wait operation, right? Wait operation. We just, if this value is less than or equal to zero, then we just wait, okay? Then after that, we minus. So this is a kind of a directly translated the semantics of our xamarin, but it's not the same as we discussed for the operation with semaphore, right? In semaphore, actually, we first decrement the value, then we will wait, right? But here, if this value is less than or equal to zero, we directly wait, okay? Then after that, we do minus minus, okay? Basically, this is how we implement using semaphore. Post operation, basically increment the value. Okay. So this is how, then we signal, right? We signal our thread waiting for. So kind of this one can implement the function of the semaphore. So, but we do have some problem here. So first, the value of the semaphore actually cannot be maintained here because we don't have this value. You can see here, basically, because we use a conditional variable, right? So we only see that if this value is less than or equal to zero, we already wait, right? So the value in our case should never be lower than zero, right? However, in the semaphore, actually, we can make it less than zero, right? But this is a simple, very simple implementation. Then if we want to maintain the value, then we have to add other variable to help us to record those value. So, yeah. Okay, so then with this one, I think I'm finished this part. So any questions related to this? Yeah, you see, okay, I think the question related to, I got one question related to the operation, right? So decrement. So because this implementation always look at the value, look at the semaphore value. If the semaphore value is less than or equal to zero at this moment, then we will wait already. Okay, then we will, after wake up, you can see after wake up, then we will do minus minus. Okay, so basically we'll do decrement after this operation. Okay. So this value, in this implementation, this value cannot be lower than zero, okay? So basically, this is the one implementation, use a conditional variable to implement the function of a semaphore. It's not a full implementation. So only a kind of a implementation use a conditional variable. So the question, I think I got some question related to it. Okay, so let me try to answer the question, then I will give you some time to. Yeah, I think all questions relate to the implementation and so on. So maybe I will talk about this tomorrow, okay? Because I was told by the department to give you some time for the CTE. Yeah, so. I forgot, is it 15 minutes or let me see. So I think maybe it's 10 minutes or something. But so let me talk about, I think all questions relate to how we implement this, right? So what are difference, what are initial value? But generally speaking, if we want to implement, then we will keep the all semantics of the semaphore. So that means a user cannot tell the difference. So we just call our original function, right? Initialize, give the initial value. Initial value will be given by the user. Okay, then here we only need to implement the function. But this is a kind of implementation uses conditional variable to implement. Right? Okay. So I will talk about this again tomorrow. So I was told by the department I should give you some time for the CTE. I remember, sorry, I forgot about the, yeah. Let me show these slides here. I was told I have to show this slide. Where is the slide? Did I copy this? Save as. Oh, here. So can you guys see my screen at this moment? Hello? Hello, guys? Okay, yeah. Okay, so I think maybe you, at this time, you should check your COHK link email, then we should provide your CTE link. Then basically the subject is like this. Then if you cannot get it, then go to your spam folder, then find it. Then there's no logging, then you just do it, okay? I should give you time to 15 minutes to fill out. Then submission deadline is by tomorrow, midnight. So I think before you guys do this, let me tell you, I'm very serious in teaching. I really care about my student. Yeah. So I hope I see, I hope I have done something, right, to show that, right? So I should not only talk about this, right? So, but I do want to tell you, okay, I really care about you guys. So the purpose here is not say that, oh, give me very high grade, high mark or something like that, okay? So certainly if you do that, welcome. But that's not purpose. So my purpose here is that I want to tell you, okay, I really care about your comments. Please put your comments over there. Then basically, we will enhance this course based on your comments. Actually, during this whole process, actually we revise this course gradually. Okay, in the beginning, actually we don't have the paper-based homework. We only have program-based homework. Okay, then I figure out, okay, maybe you guys should have some kind of a paper-based homework to understand the concept, then do the program-related homework and so on. Yeah, so, but anyway, so please input your comments, okay? Then really help us improve this course. I think this is a very important course. So basically, you really utilize the data structure to build something, right? So it's very important then for us to give you a very good learning experience and achieve a good outcome, right? So with that, I want to conclude this lecture. So I was told by the student I should kind of leave this Zoom meeting here. So can I assign this? Maybe I will. So should I? I mean, what's the purpose to leave this Zoom meeting open? Yeah. I don't know. I mean, I was told by the department say that I should. You guys give me reasonable mark. Okay, great. Thank you guys. So how about I make one student as a host, okay? So you guys help me to host this meeting until 4:15. So because this is required by the department. So can I ask, assign the helper. Right? So we don't have helper here. So can I ask Yingho to help me? Because you ask a lot of questions. Yingho, can you help me? Yeah, right? Yeah, so I make you become host, yeah. Okay, so then you guys enjoy, okay? So I will talk to you tomorrow. Okay, bye-bye.